As the war in Europe slowly progressed, the Luftwaffe found itself in a desperate struggle to fend off ever-increasing Allied bombing raids. These desperate times demanded a desperate solution, which came in the form of many experimental aircraft and other technological proposals. Some of these included developing ramjet engines that could be powered using alternative fuels and aircraft designs that could potentially reach supersonic speed. The man who tried to combine them into a single design was Alexander Martin Lippisch and his bizarre-looking P-13A flying triangle. In the later stages of the war, chronic fuel shortages caused major issues for the Luftwaffe in opposing the Allies. As one solution to overcome this rising problem, it was proposed to speed up the development of ramjet engines. They were designed to use compressed air mixed with fuel to create thrust, but without a mechanical compressor. In contrast to jet engines, ramjet engines were much simpler to build in theory and could be adapted to use other types of fuel beyond aviation gasoline. The downside was that it could not function during takeoff as it required a high volume of airflow to function. Thus, an auxiliary power plant was needed. The first working prototype was built and tested in 1942, mounting the engine in a Dornier Du 17 and later a Du 217. While the ramjet was being developed, the Germans needed a suitable aircraft for it to be equipped with. This is where tailless delta wing designs enthusiast and engineer Alexander Martin Lippisch came into play. He made a breakthrough with the construction of a rocket-powered glider known as the DFS-194, and after some time spent refining this design, it eventually led to the development of the ME-163 rocket-powered interceptor. In 1942, Lippisch left Messerschmitt. Instead, he joined the Aeronautic Research Institute in Vienna, where he continued working on his delta-wing aircraft designs. In May of 1943, he became director of this institution, and at that time, work on a supersonic aircraft was initiated. In October 1943, Lippisch won a contract to develop the experimental P-11 delta-wing aircraft. Lippisch became interested in merging his new work with a ramjet engine, leading to the P-12. In the early stages of the project, Lippisch and his team were not completely sure what to use as fuel for their aircraft. The entire project experienced a major setback when the facilities where he and his team worked were bombed by the Allies. In addition to the damage to the project itself, over 45 team members died during this raid. To further complicate matters, the scarcity of gasoline meant that Lippisch's team were forced to seek other available resources such as different forms of coal. This led to the creation of the slightly modified project named P-13. In contrast to the P-12, the cockpit was relocated from the fuselage into a large fin. This design provided better stability while also increasing the aircraft's aerodynamic properties. The P-12 and P-13 small-scale models were successfully tested at Spitzberg Airfield near Vienna in May of 1944. The project even received a green light from the Ministry of Armaments. In the early stages of the project, there were some concerns that the radical new design would require the extensive retraining of pilots. However, the wind tunnel test showed that the design was aerodynamically feasible and that the aircraft had no major control issues. Based on these tests, work on the experimental aircraft was ordered to begin as soon as possible. As work on the P-13 went on, the name was slightly changed. This was necessary as different variations were proposed. The original P-13 received the prefix A, while the designations of later variants continued alphabetically. After a brief period of examination, the P-12 project was discarded in favor of P-13A. The P-13A did not have a traditional fuselage, but rather a base consisting of a delta wing. A large fin with a pilot cockpit was placed on top of it. The exact ram engine type was never specified, but it was positioned in the central fuselage with the air intake to the front and the exhaust to the rear. The total fuel load was to be around 800 kilograms. Combustion was to be initiated by using small quintiles of liquid fuel or gas flames. The overall engine design was changed several times during the work on the P-13 without any real solution to the issues of output consistency. Given that the ramjets could not work without air thrust, an auxiliary engine had to be used during takeoff, though a more practical scenario would have been to tow the P-13 until it could start its engine. The wing construction was quite robust and provided with deflectors that would prevent any potential damage to the rudders. The wing design also incorporated a sharp metal plate similar to those used for cutting enemy balloon cables. A plausible reason for this choice was the fact that, given it had no landing gear, the aircraft design had to be robust enough as to not be torn apart during landing. The wings were swept back at an angle of 60 degrees. The fin had to be enlarged to provide good flight command characteristics. The fin cockpit was provided with a large glazed canopy that offered a good view of the front and sides. While this is often how the P-13A was portrayed, Lippisch never fully decided whether he should use this version or the second version that used a smaller fin with the pilot cockpit placed above the engine intake. These two designs are drastically different from each other. Lippisch, for unknown reasons, presented the version that used the smaller fin to British intelligence officers and the large fin version to the Americans after the war. Landing was a bit unusual. To save weight, no standard landing gear was to be used. Instead, a small dolly would be used to move the aircraft. Once sufficient height was reached, the dolly was to be jettisoned. In theory, this was an easy process, but in practice, this operation offered a good chance of failure and was much less safe than conventional landing gear. The aircraft itself would land with the nose raised from the ground and then use a landing blade skid. To help absorb the landing impact, additional torsion springs were to be used. This contraption had to be activated before the landing, emerging from beneath the aircraft fuselage with a rotation point located at the front. Once released, it was to guide the aircraft toward the ground, with the torsion springs softening the landing. The entire contraption seems like a disaster just waiting to happen, and it's questionable how practical it would have been. The main issue with the P-13 project was finding the most suitable fuel. A great deal of time was spent testing and evaluating the most suitable forms of coal that could be used as fuel. Initial laboratory test runs were made using solid brown Bohemian coal in combination with oxygen to increase the burn rate. The fuel coal was tube-shaped with an estimated weight of 1 kilogram and encased in a mesh container through which the granulated coal could be ejected. Testing revealed serious problems with this concept. While a fuel tube could provide thrust that on average lasted 4 to 5 minutes, its output was unpredictable. During the testing, it was noted that due to mineral inconsistency of the coal fuel, it was impossible to achieve even burning. Additional, larger pieces of the coal fuel would be torn off and ejected into the jet stream. The final results of these tests are unknown, but seem to have led nowhere, with the concept being abandoned. While working on the P-12 and P-13, Lippisch was approached by a group of students from the Darmstadt and Munich universities, who were interested in being involved in his projects. Lippisch agreed to this and dispatched one of his assistants. This group moved to a small warehouse and began working on the DM-1 wooden glider. It did not have a traditional fuselage, but instead its base consisted of a delta wing with a large fin on top. The cockpit was positioned in front of the aircraft with a large vertical stabilizer. To provide a better view of the lower parts of the nose, it was glazed. The landing gear consisted of 3 small landing wheels which retracted up into the wing fuselage. Given that it was to be used as a test glider and no operational engine was ever to be used on it. While it was under construction, preparations were made for its first test flight. As it was a glider, it needed a towing aircraft, and a Seibel SI-204 twin-engine aircraft was chosen for the job. However, this was not to be done like any other glider, being towed behind the larger aircraft. Instead, the DM-1 was to be placed above the SI-201 in a frame, in a similar combination as the Mistel project. In any case, the glider was almost completed by the time the war ended and was later captured by the Western Allies. Under the U.S. Army's supervision, the glider was fully completed and sent to America for evaluation. The precise purpose of the P-13A is not quite clear, even to this day. Despite being briefly considered for mass production, no official offensive armament is mentioned in the sources. So how would the P-13A have engaged the enemy? In an after-war interrogation by British officers, Lippisch was asked if the P-13 was to be used as an aerial ram aircraft. The following statement was quoted from that interrogation. The possibilities of using the P-13 as a ramming aircraft had been considered, but Dr. Lippisch did not think that athodide propulsion was very suitable for this purpose, owing to the risk of pieces of the rammed aircraft entering the air tank. This would be avoided with a rocket-propelled rammer. This statement contradicts the building description issued in late 1944. Due to tactical considerations, among other things, the speed difference of fighters and bombers, preferably when attacking from behind, though the thought was given to the installation of brakes, and though ample room for weaponry is present, the task of ram fighter has been taken into account, so that the ramming attack will not lead to the loss of the aircraft, thanks to its shape and static structure. This meant that the concept may have been considered by Lippisch at some point in the project's development. The P-13's overall shape closely resembles aircraft that were intentionally designed for this role. That being said, the use of such tactics had been considered but rejected as it was seen as a futile and flawed concept. The project itself never got far enough to even have an armament decided for it. In May 1945, Lippisch and his team had to flee toward the west to avoid being captured by the advancing Soviets. They ended up in trouble in western Austria, where they encountered the Allies. Lippisch was later transported to Paris in late May of 1945 to be questioned about his delta wing designs. He was then moved to England and then to America in 1946. The following year, American engineers with the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics tested the DM-1 glider at the unique full-scale wind tunnel facility at the Langley Memorial Aeronautical Laboratory in Hampton, Virginia. Testing seemed promising, and it was suggested to begin preparation for a real test flight. Ironically, Lippisch was not mentioned in this report, as technically speaking, he was not involved in the DM-1 project. Nevertheless, he was invited for further testing and evaluation of the glider. Whether this glider and work had any real impact on U.S. designs is not quite clear. Despite no flight-ready production aircraft ever being completed, one full-size replica of this unusual aircraft was built after the war. That replica can now be seen at the American Military Aviation Museum located in Virginia Beach, Virginia. This concludes our look at the P-13A and the DM-1. What do you think about these two aircraft? Wunderbar for Wunder waste of time? Let us know in the comments. And if you like what we do and want to see more, remember to subscribe so you don't miss a single video. Also, don't forget to take a look at our extensive collection of articles on our website, plane-encyclopedia.com. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you around the airfield.